The official Go user survey showed that Visual Studio Code is the most popular editor for Go development. Features like smart code completion, debugging support, and extensions for Docker could explain why. Ramya is here to show us what the Go developer experience is like in VS Code today on Azure Friday. Hey everybody, I'm Erik St, and today on Azure Friday, we have Ramya here with us who's going to talk to us about the development experience in VS Code for Go developers. So, welcome Ramya.
Hi, thanks.
So excited to have you here.
Very happy to be here.
So, what do you got to show us today?
So, we'll talk about the Go support in Visual Studio Code. I'll start from a basic Hello World app and build it up and show you all the cool things about it.
Oh, excellent.
All right, so as you can see, this is the Go extension in the marketplace. There are a host of language features that can help you in your day-to-day development, be it if you're code editing, you're navigating your code, you're testing your code, trying to find errors, or if you're debugging. We have something for each of these areas, and we'll touch briefly upon each of these today. I know I have a utility for strings called stringutil. That's a custom package, and whoops, typo. Let's do that.
We all still do it.
Yes. So what I wanted to show here is you get the completion even if the custom package is not yet imported. So I see that reverse string there, so I'll choose that.
So this just crawls your Go path looking for anything that you might actually be trying to import?
What I do behind the scene is I already know the package name, and I slip it in and then call Go code, and Go code does the rest.
Gotcha.
Yeah. So all right, so let's reverse a string here. That's what's hello in reverse. That should do it. All right, but there's no use just doing that, right? Let's wrap that up in a print statement. Okay, that looks good. Now at this point, you can hover over any of the symbols and you will see the signature as well as the docs associated with that function. So that's very helpful if you want to quickly know what each of the symbols are doing or how they do it. We use this reverse function, but we don't really know what it does. I mean, can we really trust the docs over here? So let's go see what it does. So you can F12. That takes you to the actual file. So let's do that. And looks like it's pretty much doing what it says. Takes the string, reverses it, gives it back. That's good for us. Let's see code navigation-wise what else we can do. You can do find all references. That will show you a peek window right here, giving you all the places where this function was used. What's the next thing we want to see? Let's see what the extension does in the area of errors and warnings, right? So let me introduce an error. Rune becomes something else. Let's remove the comment. We all know what happens now. Linter is going to scream at us saying that an exported member needs to have a comment. And you can see you have the squiggly lines saying just the same.
Now, this is great that it actually does the linting stuff for you in line.
Yeah. So what happens behind the scenes is on every file save, by default, we run build, we run linters, and we run gobet. So, and the results of all of those are shown as problems in the editor. Very aptly named is the problems view right here. So this shows all the errors and warnings in your files. So here I'm using F8. It goes to the error, another F8 goes to the next error.
Just continues
or warning.
To jump next.
Yeah. So you can imagine again, if this is a large file, you have errors, say, up somewhere and then somewhere sparsely down, you can just F8 your way around it instead of scrolling around and seeing where the error is.
Now, is the problems view just for the one file you're working on, or is that for the entire project?
Good question. So by default, it works on the package you're currently editing. Because when you save, we build, lint, and vet the current package. So if you have multiple packages and you've opened all of that in VS Code, run go build workspace. And that'll build everything, and all the errors would show up in the problems view.
Awesome.
Let's go to the test file. You could either go to the Explorer or find it or just open the file. Another handy way to do it is this toggle test file method here, command. So you toggle it, and you land in the corresponding test file. If you did not have a corresponding test file, this would generate the file for you and have some placeholders and test skeletons for each of your exported members.
Oh, sort of like a template of...
Yes. Yeah. We use behind the scenes a tool called GoTests for that.
Okay.
It was a community integration. That's a very cool feature. People love it.
Less typing is always great.
Less typing is always great. To run the test, there's a bunch of commands based on whether you want to just run the single test, all tests in a file, alters in a package or alters in your workspace. So you can use any of these commands for that.
I'm already seeing some fun links there.
Yes. There are these handy links we call code lens above functions. So you can just click on that, and it'll run the tests for you.
And this is just the single one for that particular export.
But you also have these run file tests that'll run all the tests in a file, or run package tests, which will run all the tests in the package.
OK, so they just kind of sit right above the package line.
Yes. Yeah. So the debug tests right there next to the run test code lens. Let's see how easy that is. So I'll put a breakpoint there. I'll click on debug. There you go, breakpoint hit. So then I can use this handy bar here to step in, go over the loop, step out, keep continuing. And since there were three test cases, it went through all of them. And there you have it, debugging the tests, as simple as that. Remember, everything that I do using a mouse here, you can use keyboard shortcuts for it. Everything that's in the context menu has a corresponding command in the command palette. So any pick, however you want to use VS Code, you can use it. We did debugging tests, but how about debugging the actual program? Is it that easy as debugging tests? Of course it is. So we are here back in Hello Go. So I just press F5 right now, and that's it. Delve is started in the background, and you hit your breakpoints. You can do the same dance again. You can go over things, step out, step in, continue the whole shebang. Now, let's take off the kid gloves, right? Let's go on to something more complicated. Let's talk about a web app. I have another project here. This is from the Golang example repo. What this is supposed to be doing is run a web server that will tell you whether a particular version of Go is out yet or not. That's why it's called out yet. So let me see what this does. I'll F5 this. So that is running, OK. I go to the browser, the localhost 8080, and there it is. That's the thing that it says, 1.4 is out.
That's been out for a long time.
It has been on for a long time,
right? I hope
nobody's
asking that still.
Yes, let's fix that, actually. So 1.4 was a long, long time ago. Let's see how to fix that. So probably that 1.4 is hard-coded somewhere right there. It's a parameter to this function, to this program. So if I'm debugging, and I want to send a parameter to the program. How do I do that? A simple F5 won't help here. So we go to configuration. So here on the left side, you click on this. This will create a default debug configuration for you. What's interesting for us right now is this args. So let's pass that arg. What is it, 1.11 is the hot new thing? Let's try that. Coming back here. So I want to set some breakpoints right before we serve the page. So let's do that. And now I F5. That's running. Back to the browser. Breakpoint hit. So that's good. What's the data being sent? There's a URL, and there's some data. Let's go back to the browser and see it.
Oh, that's awesome. So when you hover over the data, it actually tells you what's passed in there,
yes.
what's the value of that.
Yeah, all variables, you can just hover over it to see what the value is. Or on the left-hand side, you have all the local variables. So let's continue this thing and see if 1.11 is released. It's not. So now we go to production. Let's containerize this thing, right? So for containers, we have this handy extension called Docker. This is what we're going to use. You can imagine, generally, if you were to start from scratch, you have to create the dockerfile, decide whether you need to compose up, compose down, whether you have to remember all the command line arguments, which is great for some people, but not for others, right? So we try to make it easier for you. So the Docker extension has this whole view for itself. And let's see what I can do with it. So in the commands, the first thing I'll do is add some Docker files to this workspace, right? So I'll choose that. It gives me a set of options. I'm going to go with Go because, well, Go. let's choose that. I'll give it a port. And let's see, did it do something? It did. It created these files.
This is perfect because I hate typing those every single time.
Right? Yeah. So now it's just one command away. So let's see what it did. This is the Dockerfile, and it's a multi-stage build. You use one big image for building, and then a lighter image for actually running the app. So that's good. Let's see, can we build this image? Okay, choose the file, tag it, because we have to tag. So you can see the progress here in the terminal. It did everything it has to do. And I can see, there it is. A few seconds ago, I have the out-yet image built.
Right, this there. Is going to make me use the terminal a lot less. And I'm a terminal person.
That's my goal. So, okay, back to this. You can now run containers from using this image, either from the command palette or if you're a context menu kind of person, just say run. And this runs. Again, look at the terminal. It does what you usually do with the terminals with all the command line arguments. And here's your container. It's running. The green dot says it's running. It would be red if it was stopped.
Now, all of this is just interacting with Docker that's running on your local system, right?
Yes, yes. So we have the container running. Let's test that. It's back to 1.4 again, because now it's running from the using the default argument. Let's see if we can change that here. One of the files we created for you was the Docker Compose. So here's where you can change or pass extra things to your Dockerfile and run it, right, and customize it. So let's change the entry point and pass the argument. All right, so let's see. Let's stop this container. And that's stopped and gone. Let me compose up. Oh, that was down. Sorry. Docker compose up. I'll choose the file. And there you go. I have another container running. Now this should be using 1.11. There you go.
And it works.
It works.
Except still bad news.
Still bad news, but you know.
It would have been awesome if in the middle of our conversation it came out.
Yes, that would have been great. All right, so we had compose up. That means there's a compose down. And you bring it down. So that, in a nutshell, or a very large nutshell, is what everything you can do with VS Code and Go and the Docker extension.
Well, thanks so much for coming in and showing me all these cool new tools I'm going to have to play with.
Yep. To check out what else you can do with the extension, just go to the extensions view, click on the extension. This is the same README that you can see on the website, but more interesting is the contribution sections. All of these are settings that you can use to customize your own VS Code instance, and of course, the changelog.
Awesome. Well, thanks so much. We're learning all about the development experience in VS Code for Go developers on Azure Friday.